All right, come on, let's all clear our throats then. Come on. As soon as I open the mic, great timing. Call for Cats from Squeeze from the Greatest Hits CD, which is number 9 in the national chart. You two must be absolutely delighted. In fact, let me introduce you two. Forgive me. Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook from the aforementioned Squeeze. Welcome, gentlemen, to 1FM tonight.
Good evening.
Yes, good evening.
Nice to see you. You must be delighted. This is number 9 in the charts.
It's fantastic. It's some time since we've been number 9 in the charts, as I expect some people will know. It's a sort of occurrence that gives you a bit of a spring in the step, but you can't put too much store by it, I think.
Well, I actually was reading the research on you, and I came across Call for Cats, and it said that the idea for that came from the late Benny Hill. Is this true?
Well, lyrically, I happened to be watching a Benny Hill programme just before it was written, so it was written in that kind of Ernie the Milkman type sort of scan. But the song, to me, is like one's old wedding suit.
I think there's something duff with your microphone, actually.
Yeah.
I'll talk through the acoustic.
Yeah, bring the acoustic. Talk through the acoustic one.
Yes, I remember that song.
Yes, you're too close to that one. We'll have to figure that one out, actually. So I think what I'll do is... Oh, it's all right, is it? Okay, they tell me it's all right in there. I was looking at the research, as I said, and it just seemed astonishing to me that you lot have been together for 18 years. Well, it just doesn't seem that long. I mean, I remember doing an interview with you, I think you reminded me of this, in the basement of A&M Records in about 1974.
77. It was 77, I know.
77.
That's when it was. Yeah. That's when we signed to A&M. Yes, we've been together for an incredible amount of time. Chris and I particularly have been together. We've been writing now together for 19 years, which is... a fabulous amount of time to spend working with one person, you know. The band it has had a few changes of characters over the years. I think we've
we'll get on to the various changes of character and personnel a little later. But I was wondering, Glenn, when you answered that ad in 1974, you answered Chris's ad that was in a sweetie shop in March 1974, and the ad said, "Guitarist needed, influences Kinks, Lou Reed and Glenn Miller." Did you ever think that this would lead to a steady job?
Well, I was very optimistic that at that point, in fact, you know, since I can remember, I wanted to be a musician. And so I thought, well, this is fantastic. You know, there's a diverse set of influences. And this band are making a record and going on tour and things. And that sounded very encouraging to me. And indeed, when I met Chris, despite the fact that there was not a grain of truth behind the fact that there was a band, or that there certainly wasn't any tour, there were no recording prospects.
You told a fib, Chris?
The guitar to play.
that's not true, but what there was Chris, who even at that point was an incredibly talented songwriter, I thought. Particularly his lyrics astounded me at that time, far beyond anything I could do. And we formed a very close friendship very quickly.
Because, you two have sort of been together for more years than most married couples, actually. I mean, you've been through all these traumas with the band, and yet you two have really stayed, relatively good mates throughout.
Yeah, well, we have a distance, when we go off to write our songs, where we spend time on our own writing our individual parts, and I think that's the sort of thing that gives you strength to come back and bring something new to the partnership.
So like Elton John and Bernie Taupin, separate rooms, same sort of thing?
That sort of thing, yeah. In fact, I was reading this very day about their marriage.
Well, let's get into some live music, because that's why you're here tonight. We're going to have 5 numbers from you. And the first one, we've got the 1FM Clavinova. I think that's how you describe it. It's a sort of electric piano with sample bits in it, isn't it?
That's right. And I'd ask, not that I'm making apologies, I'm very keen to point that out before we start. I'm not making any apologies, but this is an instrument which has an inbuilt drum machine, and it has a setting called Bossa Nova, which is a sort of setting that this song was written with several years ago. And we are, I believe, we're the first people to use the 1FM Clavinova with the drum machine at this portion of the day.
Yes, this is... at this time of night, you're the first people ever on 1FM to use it at 20 to 11 on Thursday the 4th of June.
Here we go.
Yes.
That's fantastic.
Take me, I'm yours.
One, two, three, four. I've come across a desert to greet you with a smile. My camel looks so tired, it's hardly worth my while to tell you of my travels across the Golden East. I see your preparations, invite me first to feast. Can we have more piano, please? Take me, I'm yours, because dreams are made of this. Forever there'll be a heaven in your kiss. Amusing belly dances distract me from a wine across Tibetan mountains and memories of mine. I stood some ghostly moments with natives in the hills, recorded here on paper, my chills and thrills and spills. I'm yours, because dreams are made of this. Forever there'll be a heaven in your some welcome you never seem to change. Your great potential is your romantic gesture strange. My ego flies tomorrow, it's a game I treasure dear, to seek the helpless future. My love at last, I'm here. Take me, I'm yours, because dreams are made of this. Forever there'll be a heaven.
Yes, Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook and Phil Collins on drums there. Well done, Phil. Squeeze an Hourglass from my guests live in the studio tonight, Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook. I gather that that song was written out of some sort of frustration. I mean, although it's sort of nice and bouncy and stuff, I mean, there is a sort of frustrating lyric there. And I'd like to get on to sort of talk about some of the lyrical quality. But is it true that that was sort of born out of frustration there?
Well, there was a period around that time when there was a couple of songs, actually, that talked about the sort of the ebb and flow of time and how if you're not too careful, years can just go drifting by without you actually making too much of things. So I think around that time, the band had just got back together again for a couple of years, and it was a big sort of it was a big event to be back together again, and it was really about making the most of it, I think, trying to get back into the high notch, as it were.
Mm. Well, let me take you back, actually, to the time when Jules decided to leave the band, because you signed to A&M in, what, 77? And you became, I suppose, the company's sort of first new wave signing since the Pistols. I mean, which is... when you look back at it now, is that kind of strange? Because you were the sort of... the great new hope. You were part of that first of the new wave, very much.
That's right. I think that... the label New Wave was always a bit misleading, although I think we were more than happy to have it draped around our shoulders. I think that, you know, how I see the band is that we're, in fact, I think we were always a pop band, and when we went into the studio to make our first album, it was a bit of a diversion because we worked with John Cale and he brought out something very different. Actually, there was a good percentage of John Cale in our first record.
Yes, you've actually described it as being a John Cale record that you guested on.
Well, that's a bit unkind. I think, yeah, I probably did say that, and it sounds like the sort of thing I'd say. But I think, really, in all honesty, what he did was he took the set of songs that we had at that time and said, right, OK, we'll forget these, and now you're going to sit down and write 12 more songs. And what came out, I think, was very influenced by what he wanted us to do.
Mm. All right, well, then in August 1980, Jules left the band and was replaced by Paul Carrack. How did you, and I know people are going to want me to ask you about Jules, which I am going to talk about, but how did you feel then? Because you were then really very much on a high. I mean, everybody was talking about you. Your records were being played constantly by all of the radio stations. Mm. And suddenly Jules decided, right, I'm off. I'm going to go and sort of be a megastar and be on the television and have his own band, etc. Well, I mean, that must have come as a bit of a blow.
Well, it was a sad blow, but at that time we'd reached a crossroads where we wanted to change management and we wanted to make sort of certain changes to our lifestyle. And Jules had decided that he very much wanted to stay with the manager that we had at that particular time, and got him the in into the tube, as it were, you know, to go along to the audition for it. And I remember being very let down over the fact that Jules had left, because we'd all sort of, if you like, loosely speaking, grown up together for quite a few years, and sort of we'd all taken the knocks together as well as the success.
Mm.
So it was a bit of a shock when he left.
Glenn, do you remember the time when Jules came to you and said, sorry chaps, I'm going off to be on the tube and I'm going to go and get my own band? Do you remember the actual incident? You must remember the time.
Yes, I remember it vividly. With the exception that he wasn't going, I mean, he left in 1980 and the tube didn't start till 1983, so what he did was in fact to leave to pursue his own career, whatever that may be. And at the time I felt very saddened by his decision. On the other hand, I think...
Well, I mean, was it over dinner? Was it over lunch? I mean, did you go to the pub? Or
he came around and knocked at my flat at lunchtime and said, look, I've decided I want to leave the band. And I said, oh, come on, you've got to be joking. But he wasn't. And that was quite clear. I don't think I spoke to him for about a year after that.
I mean, you laugh. I mean, is that serious? You really didn't talk to him?
Yeah. Because I was very upset. Hmm. Very upset and offended. But, you know, I think you have to balance that against the other side of the coin, which is that already by that time, Chris and I were, indeed always had been, dominating Squeeze as writers. Mm. And you have to also bear in mind that I'd known Jules for longer than I'd known Chris, but we'd never struck up that sort of writing relationship. So, you know, horses for courses, I think it was a fair enough decision, as upsetting as it was.
OK, well, it's something I'd like to return to, the sort of the little bit of history and Jules coming back and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But now let's get into some more live music and Up the Junction. And first, before you actually get into this, the inspiration behind this song, because I've always been fascinated by the lyrics on this. Inspiration for this.
Well, the inspiration came from basically watching armchair theatres, the Wednesday play that was a big thing on the BBC for many years. You know, those sort of short vignette, the short stories that were on for like half an hour. They were very influential to me as a kid. You know, I like to delve in and, you know, look through the television at other people's lives. Mm. And, you know, I just thought that it would be a good idea possibly to have some characters like that in the course of a short song, in a lyric without any verses.
Well, let's hear it.
No, without any choruses.
I thought that's so what you meant.
I think we'll just play the choruses.
And that was it.
Fine. Okay, Up the Junction, live on 1FM.
I never thought it would happen with me and the girl from Clapham out on the windy common. Night I ain't forgotten. Was she down out the rations for some or other passions? I said, you are a lady. Perhaps she said, I may be. We moved into a basement with thoughts of our engagement. We stayed in by the telly, although the room was smelly. We spent our time just kissing, the railway arms were missing. This lover got us hooked up, and all our time it took up. I got a job with Stanley, he said I'd come in handy. Started me on Monday, so I had a bath on Sunday. I worked 11 hours and bought the girl some flowers. She said she'd seen a doctor, but nothing now could stop her. I worked all through the winter, the weather bright and bitter. I put away a tenner each week to make her better. And when the time was ready, we had to sell the telly. The evenings by the fire, with little kicks inside her. This morning at 4:50, I took her around the nifty, down to an incubator. But 30 minutes later, she gave birth to a daughter, within a year a walker. She looked just like a mother, if there could be another. Now she's 2 years older, her mother's with a soldier. She left me with my drinking, became a proper stand. The devil came and took me from Barter Street to Bookie. No more nights by the telly, no more nights nappy smelling. Alone here in the kitchen, I feel there's something missing. I beg for some forgiveness, but begging's not my business. And she won't write a letter, though I always tell her. And so it's my assumption, I'm really up the junction.
Nice little segue there. Thank you for that. How do you? I know you were both listening intently to that because we're obviously playing it from the CD. They sound, I mean, much crisper, these songs, now they've been remastered on CD. Don't you think?
It's incredible. I went up to Abbey Road when we did the remastering, and a lot of trouble was taken over doing it. And it was interesting. The guy who did it said, "Pull out, you know, what you think is the grungiest track." And I've always thought of our stuff, particularly our earlier stuff. I wouldn't count any Get Your Gun within that bracket, but the earlier stuff was very sort of mid-range and not particularly well recorded. So I thought, so we listened to the 45s and under CD version of Pulling Mussels, and there it was as I knew it, sort of middly, not much top and bottom, no definition. He said, right, well, here's the then compare that to the master tape. The master tape was twice as good as that. And then he ran the master tape into this program called No Noise, which just analyzes all the tape hiss, takes out all the tape hiss, and adds top and bottom frequencies as and when you want them. And it sounded like, you know, pulled socks out of your ears, and here it was for the first time, as it should have sounded.
I must admit that I'm a bit of a purist, and although I was saying to you that I very much like the sort of sound of CD, but I'm actually going back to playing vinyl at home. I like that kind of warmth. Anyway, let's go back to your history. Squeeze, This Is Your Life, my guest tonight on 1FM, Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook. We were talking about Jules leaving in when was it, August 1980. He was replaced by Paul Carrack, a wonderful voice, a wonderful person, actually, from Ace. And then in 82, 2 years later, the whole thing split up. It all sort of exploded into a zillion pieces. And all the reports say that the split was well, acrimonious, I think is the nicest way to put it. What was it like from your point of view? And I also read, actually, that you two didn't even discuss it with the rest of the band. It was just like, that's it, gone, finished, bye.
Well, I think that certain parts of that are true. I think what happened is that we felt at that time, Chris and I had both felt individually, that the band was getting a bit tired. And I think from our point of view, being quite young, having done 5 years of an album a year and lots of touring, it's a lot to take on board. And if you have no sort of other life than that. At that point, I think we were going a bit round the bend, and it was definitely time for a rest. I don't think we knew it was time for a rest. I think we thought, well that's it then. You know, it's gone downhill, and it's time to quit.
In what kind of ways did you think that you were going round the bend?
I think that anyone who's in the entertainment business and does a lot of touring and a lot of work will at some point or other come close to going round the bend, unless you're very firmly rooted in something or other.
You're not being very. I'm trying to get.
What do you want me to say?
I'm trying to get you to be specific. Actually.
I think just the whole
rock and roll lifestyle,
the whole experience of being successful, I think, is quite bewildering. It's everything that you want it to be, but there's something else about being. Recognize them. You know, I have to bear in mind, of course, that we were never particularly huge, but nevertheless, large enough to be recognized, to have your whole life change. And, you know, I found that a very enjoyable experience. It does change you. It's whether you can cope with that change.
Well, there was a quote here from you, Glenn, that said, quote, "I had a taste of being quite famous around the time of Call for Cats and Up the Junction, and I can't say that I enjoyed it a lot. I've always been more content with middling success." That was a recent quote of yours, Glenn.
That's right, yeah, that's right.
You agree with that?
Well, for my personal life, and you have to balance up, you know, life within and without music. I'm incredibly wrapped up in music, always have been, and always will be. Whether I want that to dominate everything I do is questionable. I hanker for, you know, I think that someone, and I compare us not in any other way to Pink Floyd, but Pink Floyd have a very good level of success whereby they sell lots of records and retain their anonymity to a certain extent.
Mm. Funnily enough, actually, I was talking to Dave Gilmore only a few hours ago, and I mean, I actually know him quite well, and I mean, he can go to Tesco's quite easily. No one knows who the hell he is. Yeah. He loves that.
Fantastic, yeah, I think that's really smart.
So how did you feel, Chris, when the split came? I mean, were you in perfect agreement with Glenn that, you know, this was the right thing to do and Squeeze had had their day?
Yeah, it's something that we'd both been thinking subconsciously but not actually put on the table to which is kind of what happened anyway, because Glenn and I went off and did a solo album and a bit of a musical and stuff before Squeeze came back together again.
That musical was what labeled with Love.
With Love, yeah.
And you did an album together, which was called Difford and Tilbrook.
Yeah.
Which
very
wasn't
rare.
It wasn't very successful. I mean, I do remember the album. It didn't sell very well. But no. I also saw a quote from one of you, and I don't know which one of you, but one of you said that if it had been Squeeze, if it had been, you know, labeled Squeeze instead of Difford and Tilbrook, it would have been a hit. Which one of you said that? Or is
I don't know. Whether
do you agree with that, though?
I think if the musicians of Squeeze, and this isn't a knock to any of the musicians that played on it at all, but I think if it had been, you know, I've heard Squeeze playing Love's Crashing Waves, and it far surpasses the version that we had in my mind. Julian played an excellent piano solo on it, and Gilson played a really thundering drum rhythm track to it. You know, we went off and formed the Difford and Tilbrook band, which was a great band, but it's something, it's the kind of magic that you can't get that you with somebody that you've been working with for many, many years.
Well, there's obviously a good friendship and a real sort of empathy between the two of you, so let's hear some more music now. We're going to actually hear two. You're going to do two on the trot. The second one will be Label with Love, and the first one is Pulling Mussels. It's 6 minutes past 11. Don't forget, on 1FM after midnight tonight, it's Bob Harris until 4, my guests Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook. So let's hear Pulling Mussels.
Two, three, four.
They do it down on campus, they do it at Waikiki. Lazing about the beach all day at night, the cricket's creepy. Screening faces at the sky, a Harold Robbins paperback. Surfers drop their boards and dry, and everybody wants a hat. But behind the chalet, my holiday's complete, and I feel like William Tell made Marion on her tiptoe feet. Pulling Mussels to Michelle, pulling Mussels to Michelle. Drinking from the sea so cold, topless ladies look away. A he-man and a sudden shower, shadows from the rain. You wish you had a motorboat to pose around the harbor bar. And when the sun goes out to bed, you hook it up behind the car. But behind holiday's complete, and I feel like William Tell made Marion on her tiptoe feet. Pulling Mussels to Michelle, pulling Mussels to Michelle. Two fat ladies, window shop, something for the mantelpiece. For bingo, all the nines are panda for sweet little knees. Coach driver stand about, looking at a local map about the boy who's gone away down to next door's caravan. But behind the chalet, my holiday's complete, and I feel like William Tell made Marion on her tiptoe feet. Pulling Mussels to Michelle, pulling Mussels to Michelle. But behind the chalet, my holiday's complete, and I feel like William Tell made Marion on her tiptoe. Mussels to Michelle, pulling Mussels to Michelle. She unscrews the top of a new whiskey bottle, shuffles about in her candlelit hovel, like some kind of witch with blue fingers and mittens. She smells like the cat and the neighbors she sickens. The black and white TV has long seen a picture. The cross on the wall is a permanent fixture. The postman delivers the final reminders. She sells off the silver in China. Drinks to remember I, me and myself, winds up the clock and knocks dust from the shelf. Home is a love that I miss very much, so the past has been bottled and labeled with love. During the wartime, an American pilot made every air raid a time of excitement. So she moved to Barry and married the Texan. She learned from a distance how love was a lesson. He became drinker and she became mother. She knew that one day she'd be one or the other. He had himself older, drunk himself dizzy, proud of her features. She kept herself pretty. Drinks to remember, I, me and myself. Winds up the clock, knocks dust from the shelf. Home is a love that I miss very much. So the past has been bottled and labeled with love. He like a cowboy died drunk in a slumber. Out on the porch in the middle of summer. So she crossed the ocean back home to her family. But they had retired to roads that are sandy. She moved home alone without friends or relations. Lived in a world full of age reservation. A moth-eaten objects, she'd say that she'd sawed off friends who had left her to drink from the bottle. Drinks to remember, I, me and myself. Winds up the clock, knocks dust from the shelf. Home is a love that I miss very much. So the past has been bottled and labeled with love. Drinks to remember, I, me and myself. Winds up the clock, knocks dust from the shelf. Home is a love that I miss very much. So the past has been bottled and labeled with love. The past has been bottled and labeled with love. The past has been bottled.
Thursday night from 1FM. Hello, this is Nicky Horn. Don't forget Bob Harris here between midnight and four. My guests live in the studio tonight, Chris Difford and Glenn Tilbrook of Squeeze. And that was Tough Love, which I gather was inspired from a book called Horizon House. Is this true? A book about a rehab centre. Is that true?
I heard this lady talking on Radio 4 on Start the Week, in fact, and she was talking about this fascinating book that she'd written about her tragic relationship with her children and her husband, because she was an alcoholic, and she went into this place fictitiously called Horizon House, and it was all about the tough love that she had to experience while she was there. So I went and got the book, read it, and The only thing that I sort of worried about it was it was looking behind closed, what would normally be closed doors. And although that's quite fascinating, I think it was almost like prying at some stage. You know, it felt like you were really looking into people's private lives.
What you mean? Tough love, the concept of sort of being cruel to be kind. But are you saying sort of looking into something that you had to look into in yourself as well?
No, not me particularly at that point, but I thought that's what she was doing. She was explaining and writing about her experiences and talking about all these fictional characters that she had met while she was there. Mm. And I thought that was a bit like prying.
Yeah, because I know that sort of booze, alcohol did play a part. I mean, in your sort of, in your act, I mean, and not just the act, but I mean, in your lifestyles. I just wondered whether that was a sort of semi-autobiographical.
No, not at all. I mean, Gilson, at the point of this particular album and this particular track, he had already been on the AA program for a good couple of years, and you know, I thought a lot of the things that he was talking about, and it was a big inspiration for him. It totally changed him and made him a completely different person. Mm. And it was definitely time to sort of sit up and prick up your ears and listen to what other people have to say about their lives.
All right, well, let me go back, because I want to sort of bring the historical thing sort of full circle before we have to pack up at 11:30. After, you know, you all split up, it was then, what, 2 years, and you then decided that it was the right time for Squeeze to reform. What led to that? I mean, did you sort of all get together in the pub one day and think, yeah, this could be fun again? Or how did it happen?
Well, it actually happened. I'd got a gig booked for myself. I'd been doing various odd gigs with different lineups, which is something I like to do anyway. And had forgotten about the gig, and a couple of days before it panicked and rang up everybody in Squeeze and asked if they'd fancy doing it. No rehearsal, just go straight on and do as much as we could remember. And everybody said yes. And we went along and did the gig. And it was actually one of those occasions where you realize exactly what you've been missing without ever having been aware of having missed it before. From my point of view, I thought when Squeeze folded that was it. And the idea of reforming was awful to me. But I found, much to my surprise and delight, that I was very wrong, that there was a lot more that we could do and a lot more that we hadn't done. Mm.
And so, obviously, when you got back together again, this was the best thing since wholemeal bread, right?
It was good fun. It was really enjoyable. It was like putting a comfy old pair of slippers on, something I never do.
Oh, come on. I want to ask you about Jules and the situation with Mr. Holland. I mean, maybe I'm being a little unfair about it, and please tell me if I am, but one gets the impression, being on the outside, that Jules sort of comes back to Squeeze when he's kind of really got nothing better to do. Is that unfair on Jules?
Well, I think that was the case for a while, but I don't think it's the case at the present time. You know, he was back in the band when we got back together again, as Glenn was just saying, and it was all exciting to be back together again. And then it just got to the point where Jules had so many other commitments, what with TV and his own recording career, that at one point we had to do a video for 8535937 without Jules being there, and I thought, well, that was really odd, being in a band with one member who couldn't be there because he had to be in Newcastle doing a TV show. And although you can make, you know, within a band you have to give and take, and you know, if somebody has to do something, then you just sort of have to go along with it to a certain degree. But with Jules, it was becoming a sort of all too common occurrence. So now I think it's got to the point where Squeeze is pretty much Glenn and myself and Keith, our bass player, and we're sort of looking to the future without really having a dominant person like Jules in the lineup at this particular time.
That's covering it pretty much.
Yes, so you're leaving.
Really.
So you're leaving the door open.
Well,
or not just open.
You see, slightly ajar. You don't leave the door open with Jules. He just knocks it down.
But don't you get a bit miffed? Don't you get a bit miffed though? Seriously, that there you are. You know, totally committed to the music. You're totally committed now to this band. And you've got a keyboard player who kind of like, okay, well, you know, maybe I'll do it. Doesn't that sort of,
well, it's part of Jules's, you know, in a sort of strange way, it used to niggle me on stage sometimes seeing him yawn when he was playing a piano solo. But in an odd way, it was kind of Jules, you know, it was his character. And I don't know whether one should make excuses for that or not, but you sort of get endeared to it after a while.
Okay, all right, well, we'll move off that. And in a moment, we'll actually go to talk about these gigs that you're doing, because you're going to do some acoustic dates around the country, and I'll give those dates out in a moment. And I think actually what we'll do is we'll play a track from the Greatest Hits CD, and then we'll come back with a bit of a chat and one more live track, which will be Tempting.
Great.
I love the piano.
Did you
bring that out in the remix? I don't think I've ever heard.
No,
that
that's always been there. The only time it ever appears in the song.
That's great. You're going out on the road fairly soon. In fact, let me give you the dates now. If you'd like to see Squeeze, you're going to be doing an acoustic tour. And let me give the dates. It's 16th of June, Milton Keynes Wooten Centre. 17th of June, Coventry, the TikTok Club. 18th of June, Leeds, the Irish Centre. 21st of June, St Austell, Cornwall, the Coliseum. And the 23rd and the 24th, the Town and Country Club in London. Bass player Keith Wilkinson will join the two of you. And also, I gather you've got Steve Naive as the keyboard player, is that correct?
That's right. Okay. That's one of the things, to put the boot on the other foot about the situation with Jules is that, in fact, we've had a succession of really good keyboard players going back to Paul Carrack. Don Snow, who's in after Paul, has recently been with us again and is a fantastic player. And indeed, Steve, who played on our last album, is great fun to play with. It sort of brings different things out in the songs.
And how do you feel about going back on the road? I mean, there was a quote here from you, Glenn, talking about gigs. Quote, "I don't think the venue really matters. People don't need light shows and flying pigs." Dave Gilmour, are you listening? "If you have a good time, the audience will too."
I don't think I ever said that.
That was
a quote
attributed to you.
Attributed to me. Yeah. Well, I'd say wrongly. I think flying pigs are absolutely fine. I like light shows, but we've always been.
I'll just throw that quote away then.
scrap that one. That's just that one. I think we never have been that much of a big show sort of band. We've always preferred the more intimate sort of show, be it in a large shed or in a club.
Well, I wish you well with the tour. It's really good to see the CD back in the charts, and it's good to see the two of you again. Thanks very much indeed for joining us on 1FM tonight. And time for one more, which means we're going to be a little late for the news, but I think that Alistair Sanford will wait. So, gentlemen, it's yours. Let's hear Tempted, and thanks once again.
Thanks a lot. 3, 4...
A toothbrush, some toothpaste, a flannel for my face, pajamas, a hairbrush, new shoes and a case. I said to my reflection, let's get out of this place. Past the church and the steeple, the laundry on the hill, the billboards and the buildings, memories of it still keep calling. And calling, but forget it all, I know I will. Tempted by the fruit of another, tempted but the truth is discovered. What's been going on, now that you've gone, there's no way there. Tempted by the fruit of another, but the truth has discovered. I'm at the car park, the airport, the baggage carousel.
People keep on crowding,
I'm wishing I was well. I said it's no occasion,
it's no story I can tell.
At my bedside, empty pocket, without a sock, your body gets much closer. I fumble for the clock, alarmed by the seduction. I wish that it would stop. Tempted by the fruit of another, tempted but the truth is discovered. What's been going on, you've gone, there's no other. Tempted by the fruit of another, tempted but the truth has discovered. I bought a novel, some perfume, a fortune all for you, but it's not my conscience that hates to be untrue. My reflection, tell me what is there to do. Tempted by the fruit of a leather, tempted but the truth is discovered. What's been going on, now that you've gone, there's no weather. Tempted by the fruit of a leather, truth has discovered.
Glenn and Chris, thank you very much indeed. This is 1FM at 11:32. Got some music from The Doors lined up. Now let's catch up with the latest news headlines.